can make things right. Turn all the dark to light when he splits the eastern sky. With heaven's wings I'll fly, and I will say goodbye to these tears I've cried. Around his throne of grace, we'll see him face to face with those who've gone before. Oh, we'll be apart no more. When we will hear that sound, as all are gathered round, like peals of
Amen. Hallelujah. Welcome home, church. It's great to be here and worship with you all this morning, and you have a great message ahead of you today. I am so glad that I get to hear it once again, the great and glorious and hope-filled message that Pastor Eric will be bringing to you all here in a few moments. I have one announcement for you this morning, and that is dealing with our Feed My Starving Children mobile pack. Going to be September 23rd and 24th here out in the warehouse. We'll be packing. And just to give you a little bit of a reminder of what that's all about, we have a short video clip here for you to remind you.
Seeing Omar today, you'd never know he was almost one of the 6,200 children who die each day from hunger. His future is bright thanks to Feed My Starving Children and volunteers like you who pack nutritious meals that help run orphanages, schools, and clinics across the world. Packing is so easy, even kids can do it. Yet the meals turn lives and communities around. Turn hunger into hope with your own two hands. Learn more at fmsc.org.
So you see here, this is why we do this, such a great opportunity to be able to bless others through our service and what we do. And what our goal is this year is to pack 250,000 meals to be sent to people in other countries who are in need of food, who are starving and need that food. And what we're doing this weekend, and we talked about it last weekend, but this weekend we're doing our 1 for 200. The idea being for giving up one meal out to eat, generally being $40 to $50, for that amount of money, we can provide 200 meals for these people. And as you have done that today, as we're encouraging that, if you look in your bulletin under the Feed My Starving Children, you'll see a website there. That's the fundraising page. You can go there to donate that money, that $40 to $50. If you did bring a check with you, there is a basket, a table at the back of the sanctuary. You can drop that in there. But otherwise, we encourage you to go to that site to help donate and support this service here. And put that date on your calendar, September 23rd and 24th, that you can come be a part of that and serve and pack those meals to bless those people in need. Also, along with that, remember this weekend that we encourage you to have that one of those cementing meals and make this even more meaningful, especially if you have children, to be able to sit down and have for one of your meals this weekend a meal of only rice and beans or some rice and vegetables, so you can get a feel of what it is, that one meal a day that someone might have somewhere else in the country, or in another country, what that might be for them. Just those rice and beans is the one meal they have a day. And then you can talk about how we as God's people have been called to help and step in and to care for others in the midst of their needs, and how we can do that in the midst of people's hunger in the world. So that is our only announcement for this morning, and now I invite you to stand and greet our brothers and sisters in Christ this morning. Good morning. Lord's blessings.
Good morning. Turn around, let me see you here.
Just waiting for you to make a stand.
Good morning.
Just conspicuous coming down. Good morning,
sir. Good morning. Lord's blessings.
Good morning. It is great to be in worship with you. We're excited to worship this morning because this whole month we have been talking about going from a place of mourning into a place of joy or dancing. And this week, we finally do get a picture of the hope that is to come. Pastor Trickey is going to be preaching to us about the life of the world to come. And there are so many songs that really take us to an image, which we sang even before worship began, an image of heaven and that time when we will be just singing together and glorifying God as he is in perfection, and we are made perfect as his body. We give a shout out to those who are watching online. Welcome today to worship with us. We begin our worship this morning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Bringing us from a moment of sorrow, from suffering, into joy, trusting in God.
In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, oh. You are the peace in my troubled sea.
Distress. He calmed the storm and the waves quieted down. So they rejoiced that the waves became quiet and he led them to their desired haven. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his gracious love and for his awesome deeds on behalf of mankind.
Walk right through it. My fears were drowned in pain.
co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we may also share in his glory, in the glory, the time yet to come where we know that Christ has come for us and we are resurrected with him. We're going to say the last lines of the Nicene Creed today, which really point to that time. Say this together. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Lord, fear surrounds us on all sides. Our suffering is real. Set us free. Today, bring us all the way from mourning into dancing. In your name we pray. Amen. Please be seated in the presence of Almighty God who lives and reigns forever. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. These words are our ancient words that have sustained the church. Next year, as Lutherans, we're excited. We're going to be celebrating 500 years of Reformation. But that's nothing compared to the age of these words. And in the year 2025, these words will have been 1,700 years old, written to sustain the church through all of the trials and tribulations of the last two millennia. But the question is, why do we look for things like the resurrection of dead people and a life in a world that isn't here, that we can't see or touch or feel with our senses? And as I age here, and some of you have aged even more than I have, but as I grow older, I become more and more convinced that I have to look somewhere else in order to find the hope that I need, because this world is a dark place. A month ago, 49 people were killed in Miami. A week ago, 84 people were killed in Nice. On Friday, 9 people were murdered in Munich. And yesterday morning, 80 more lost their lives in Kabul. Politicians offer rhetoric, but no real solutions. And we are desperate for a light, some hope in this dark place. And the only one who can give it to us is Christ. And so we look for him to come again and to set everything that is upside down right side up. This morning we come to the end of our month-long series From Mourning to Dancing. And a few weeks ago, we talked about the problems of suffering. We've also looked at the unbelievable resources that are available to us to handle suffering given to us by the Holy Spirit. And last week, Pastor Mark taught us what we can do to bring help and healing to other people who are suffering. But today, we're going to talk about the end of suffering. You guys with me? Now, I think one of the coolest TV shows of all time, certainly one of the coolest TV shows of the last 10 years, was one called Extreme Home Makeover. Anybody ever see that show? I love it because you get a needy family, and they get sent away on a vacation of a lifetime. And while they're gone, all of their friends and family and builders from all over and people in the community, they come together, and they have so many resources that are given to them. And in 1 week's time, they build the dream home of this family who is in need. And it is an amazing thing to see what people can accomplish in a short period of time. But I got to say, my favorite part of that show isn't watching everybody work. My favorite part is the reveal. You guys know what I'm talking about? When they get all the family and all the friends together, and on one side is all of them, and on the other is their dream home. They haven't seen it yet. And in between is this giant bus. You guys remember that? Let's watch this video together.
Move that bus! Move that bus! Move that bus!
was like an Eric Trickey move at the end there. I would do that to somebody. But my friends, I cannot wait to see the same thing happen to each and every one of you. I can't wait to see the look on Jesus' face and on your face when he reveals to you for the first time that place that he has gone to prepare for you in his Father's house. And I don't know if angels are going to be up there singing, "Move that cloud, move that cloud." But I want to see the expression on your face when every trouble and every headache and every heartache that you've ever had melts away forever. You see, the message of the book of Revelation is, it is tough here and now. Bad things happen. It's challenging. The suffering that we face is real. Problems abound. Sin disrupts our peace. Pain destroys pleasure. And innocent people suffer. But, and it is a big but, in the end, Jesus is going to win. He will come in riding on the clouds, and he will save the day once and for all. That desire that you have, that I have, deep down inside of us, to belong, to see a place prepared just for us, a place where all of the wrong things get made right and good abounds forever, that place is real. That is the promise of the book of Revelation. And wise is the person who studies these words and meditates on them. But the truth is, most people, most Christians avoid the book of Revelation. Many people think that it's too hard to understand. Anybody there? Or that it's too scary to think about all these things that might come. And too many people disagree on what all of these things mean anyway. But when we understand that the book of Revelation was written to Christians in the first century, Christians who were hurting desperately, it was written to give them hope. When we understand that, then it becomes a book that is still well worth reading and thinking about today, because we've got plenty of hurting people all around us. Amen? So today, let's try and imagine how this book must have encouraged the people that it was written to, those Christians who were living in the very first century after Christ. And let me give you a little biblical interpretation tip along the way here. The very best thing that you can do to understand the Bible and apply it to your own life is to spend a little time trying to figure out who the people were that the Bible was originally written to. What was going on in their lives? What was happening in the culture all around them? What were some of the problems that they faced? Because when you understand that, then you can rightly apply those words to yourself. Now, in the case of the revelation that John had, he was writing to encourage the early Christians, especially those who were members in the seven pillar churches in Asia Minor. And they were experiencing unbelievable persecution. The Roman government had one plan for Christianity, and that was complete obliteration. John was the only one of the disciples who was still alive when this book was written. All the other ones had been murdered and martyred. He was himself in exile on the island of Patmos, separated from the people, the church that he loved so much. But he was given this dream that is greater than a dream. And he was given it to encourage the people all around the world who were suffering. At the time of its writing, however, it felt like Rome was going to win, that the dragon was going to have its day. It seemed that Christianity was down for the count and was destined to be nothing more than a footnote in human history. But one of the great recurring themes of Revelation is that things are not always what they seem. It may seem that all is lost, but John assures them that that is not the case. Revelation speaks to its hurting and frightened audience with this truth, that as long as Christ is with us, the victory is ours. This book begins in a beautiful way. It begins by Jesus speaking. Now, John's not just quoting Jesus from way back when he walked the face of the earth. We hear fresh words from Jesus. He speaks to his church again for the first time in decades. And in this dream that is more than a dream, Jesus is speaking like he used to speak, words of hope and encouragement and guidance. Does anybody here have a red letter Bible? Do you know what that is? Most of the words are black, but there's a few words that are red letters. Those are the words that Jesus spoke. And if you have one of those Bibles, you'd open it up and you'd read the first four Gospels, and there's red letters everywhere, and there's a few red letters in Acts, but then the red letters stop. But here, when we finally get to the end, when we open up the book of Revelation, the red letters start again. Jesus speaks a fresh word to his people after 50 years of silence. And he says to them that I am the Alpha and the Omega. I am the one who is, who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. Jesus says, I am Almighty Jesus, the Alpha, from before time began, from before all worlds, I was there. And he is the Omega Jesus. Long after Rome crumbles, long after the Ottoman Empire dissolves, long after America is no more, and this world as we know it comes to an end, Jesus will still be here. This Almighty Alpha and Omega Jesus is still with his people as they suffer, and he still speaks to them. In Revelation chapter 1, he starts to speak, and he says, I turned around to see the voice that was speaking to me. John says that. And when I turned, I saw seven golden lampstands, and among the lampstands was someone like a son of man, dressed in a robe, reaching down to his feet with a golden sash around his chest. Now, we get all this imagery, and it's hard to understand what's going on here. But the lampstands are the churches, and it says that Jesus is walking among them. You see, he still speaks, and he still walks with his church, not just then, but still today. And you beautiful people, you are the church of Christ, and he still walks with you, and he still speaks to you. If you listen, you can hear. That is the revelation of John. It speaks to us in images, lampstands, and bowls full of wonder and terrors, apocalyptic horsemen, dragons, lakes of fire, pearly gates, and streets of gold. The sun gets turned out, the moon turns to blood, a new and glistening city descends from heaven, a river with the water of life starts to flow, and the tree of life, the one that was back in the Garden of Eden, it begins to grow and blossom and produce fruit once again. There is so much imagery. It's just one vision after another. There are so many metaphors there. It is more Tolkien than technical. It is more Lord of the Rings than a how-to manual. And it speaks more to our imaginations than it does to our reason. It's a dream. You kind of got to flow with it, right? It's a dream, but it has great meaning. But we must not get too literal when we're trying to understand a dream. Anybody ever have a dream that you were flying? Anybody? Me too. Now, I would say that dream of you flying means something, but it doesn't mean you can fly. Amen? You can't get too literal with these things. Getting too literal with the revelation has led more than a few people into error. It is dangerous when people take a few passages of this dream and they start to build a whole philosophical system about the end of the world. They start to teach about the rapture and the pre-trib and the post-trib millennialism. And anybody who ever says that they know the end of the world and what date it's going to happen on, I want you to turn away and run as fast as you can. Because only the Father knows those things. All those kind of weird teachings are extra biblical. They are outside of the Bible. And it makes Christians appear foolish to the world when we cling to things like those. And sometimes it even causes people to believe in false hopes. And when those things don't come true, it destroys their faith and they move far away from Jesus. Revelation is a series of pictures designed to show us that Christ is with us, that we are not alone, and that God is going to one day win the day. So let's take a look at a few of these pictures and see if we can figure some things out here. For instance, how many lampstands were there that we talked about in the earlier reading? Seven, right? And these were the seven churches of Asia Minor. The number seven is a big number in the Bible, and it means wholeness or completeness. There were 7 days of creation. Everything was created in that 7 days. There were seven evil spirits driven out of Mary Magdalene. She was completely demon-possessed. And there are seven spirits of God that are mentioned here in the book of Revelation. The Holy Spirit has complete and total wisdom and peace and power and love and joy. Revelation is a picture of Jesus walking among his total church, then and now. We are part of those seven churches that you see up there right now. This is still going on. The church is still alive and active on the face of the earth. And this vision is meant to give us hope when life gets hard. In chapter 4, we hear, "After this I looked, and there before me was a door standing open in heaven. And the voice I had first heard speaking, Jesus, to me like a trumpet said, 'Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this.' And at once I was in the Spirit, and there before me was a throne in heaven with someone sitting on it. And the one who sat there had the appearance of jasper and ruby, a rainbow that shone like an emerald encircled the throne. Surrounding the throne were 24 other thrones, and seated on them were 24 elders. They were dressed in white and had crowns of gold on their heads." And we're left with the question, what in the world does all that mean, right? John is given a glimpse of heaven, and what he sees there is a throne. Now, the big deal is not the throne itself. The big deal here is the one who is sitting on the throne, that God himself is present. And what he's really trying to say is, you think Rome is running things? You think the military-industrial complex and politicians are running things? Ha! God is on the throne. Somewhere beyond the borders of this universe, there is a throne, and God is sitting on it, and he is reigning in power for all eternity. Amen? From the throne came flashes of lightning, rumblings, and peals of thunder. In front of the throne, seven lamps were blazing, and these are the seven spirits of God. He is reigning in power, and he is active in his rule. John looks, and he sees that there are creatures in circles around this throne. He sees 24 elders, and what these 24 elders probably mean, almost certainly, is that it's the whole church, because there were 12 tribes in Israel before Christ, and there were 12 disciples that he sent after him, and so those 12 tribes and those 12 disciples represent the Old Testament and the New Testament church all together sitting around in this throne room in heaven. And he sees a circle of angels, and he sees four living creatures, which are really, really weird. Like, one of them has got like an eagle head, and one of them looks like a cow, but it's all the creatures that God ever created. All of the domestic animals and the wild animals and the animals that can fly. All of created life. And the cool thing is, none of them are looking at each other going, "Wow, you guys look really weird," right? They're not looking at heaven going, "This place is amazing." All eyes are on the throne. All eyes are on God. And John tells us that every one of them takes off their golden crown and they lay it at the feet of the one who sits on the throne. And then they start singing. Saying with a loud voice, and a better translation of that is just singing. They started singing, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them singing, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever." And the four living creatures, all of creation, said, "Amen. Amen." And the elders, the whole church, fell down and they began to worship. It's pretty cool, huh? But notice that you are not the one who is sitting on the throne. And I am not the one who is sitting on the throne. God is there. We are not the center of the universe, but He literally is. His will, not yours and not mine, is to be done. So, God is on the throne. But unlike what many people expect, just because God is reigning and just because you believe in Him, it doesn't mean you're going to have an easy life. In fact, Jesus promised us just the opposite, that if we follow after Him, we will experience much of the pain that He experienced. Revelation describes many problems and trials and tribulations. You see, there is a scroll up in this throne room of heaven, and literally, like, forever, people were trying to open up this scroll, or the angels or whatever's up there trying to open the scroll, and nobody could open it until Jesus comes along. And this is why Jesus came to earth. He came down because no one could open up that scroll, and He poured out His blood to pay the price. And He took up His own life, and He rose again, and He ascended back to that throne room of heaven, and they handed Him the scroll. And He opened that sucker up. Amen? Because only Jesus could. And that scroll is God's message to the world. But it's not always what we want to hear. You see, when He opened it up and the worship was over, a flood of plagues and problems started to flow out. And what this shows us is that the battle between the church and Satan is still going on. The war between good and evil is still being fought. Right and wrong still gets all messed up in you and all around you. The scroll is telling the church that there will be many challenges. But whenever you face a challenge, you can turn to God. Whenever there's a war or a famine, whenever you hear about persecution and death, fix your eyes back on the throne, because in the end, God wins, and He's going to save everyone who trusts in Him. In chapter 7, there are four angels ready to do some damage to the earth, and there's another angel that calls out to them, and he says, "Don't harm the sea or the earth or the trees until we've sealed the servants of God on their foreheads." Now, many people have tried to make much out of this, you know, marking on your forehead business. But all this is really saying is that God loves you so much, He will always provide what you need. No matter how great the challenges are that you face, if things don't go the way that you want, He is still going to provide everything you need. Not everything you want, but everything you need. You might lose everything. You might lose your very life, but you will never lose your relationship with Jesus Christ. That is the promise of Revelation. Revelation is a great description of heaven and earth coming together in this great collision. God's eternal story and our very mortal and limited stories getting all mixed up together. You see, we struggle in life, but we have a promise that God's going to be with us and He's going to prevail in the end. Through the moral failure of chapter 8 of Revelation, God prevails. Through the demonic forces attacking in chapter 9, God prevails. Through the dragon of chapter 12, say it with me, God prevails. Through the beast of chapter 13, God prevails. And it begins to dawn on us as we're reading through this book. I wonder if God's going to actually win. He seems to win every time. And then we reach the climax of the book of Revelation, chapter 21, and it's the big finish here. And this chapter is so important, it is deserving for all of us to memorize it, or at least read and reread, highlight it, and meditate on it again and again and again. And I invite you now to pay close attention. If you got to close your eyes, shut it all out. I just want you to hear these words, because this is the promise of heaven to you, listen. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned by her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and he himself will be their God. And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Can you imagine? No more dying. I'm so sick of dying. Neither there shall be mourning or crying or pain, for the former things have passed away. And he who was seated on the throne said, behold, I am making everything new. And then he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. And then he said to me, like he said on the cross when he defeated sin and death and hell, and he says it again on the last day, he says, it is finished. I'm the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And if you're thirsty, I'm going to give you water from the springs of the water of life, and it's going to be free. The one who conquers will have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. And if you're a girl, this is for you too. This is just an old time saying, because back in the ancient world, the sons were the only ones who could inherit the riches of the father. And all this is saying is that if you trust in God, you too will inherit all the riches of the kingdom. Now, we've been addicted to many things in our lives, all of us. But there is only one addiction that you were actually built for. Christ Jesus is the only thing you cannot get too much of. I love seeing what he has done in my life when I've given more and more of myself to him. When my life went off the rails, he was the one who brought me back and set me back on the path. And when I still fall down, he's still the one who reaches down and sets me back on my feet. And I love watching what God can do in the lives of other people who are addicted to themselves and all kinds of other things. I love being a part of God using me to help other people put their lives back together. I love teaching them who they are in him and what it is he wants them to live for. I love helping set people free and watching their faces as hope dawns, sometimes for the very first time. My friends, I am addicted to watching God wipe away every tear from people's eyes and ease their pain and turn their mourning into dancing. That's the promise of the book of Revelation. Yes, it's a fiery book. And yes, it's hard to understand, and it's full of things that we can't fully comprehend right now. But more than anything, it is a book jam-packed with hope. Because in the end of the book, there is this new Jerusalem that comes down out of heaven, and it's huge. It's huge, right? It's enormous. John describes it, and it's 1,400 miles long and 1,400 miles wide and 1,400 miles high. Now, that is a skyscraper, amen? But all he's really trying to say is that there's room for all of you. There is room for everyone who's ever trusted in Jesus, and this will be their home, this city of God where his glory dwells. We got two promises in this book. The first one is that he is with us now, no matter what we face. And the second promise is that one day we will be with him in this city, a city that is full of his glory. And when we get there, we're going to dance on golden streets, and the only tears we're going to cry are tears of joy. And I can't wait until I hear the heavenly host start singing, move that cloud, move that cloud. And I look upon the face of my beloved Jesus with these eyes, and I hear him say my name with these ears, and he welcomes me in to my eternal home. That's the hope that sustains you when cancer comes crashing into your life. That's the hope that sustains us when terror strikes, when the world invents new ways of doing evil, and all that we can see is suffering all around us. You see, it's in the midst of our mourning and in the midst of our suffering that Jesus calls tenderly to us, and he invites us to look at something else, to look to the throne, to look to the glory that awaits us, to look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. And all creation looked to God and said, Amen.
Having heard such great words of promise, having heard that great message of that glory that awaits us, that hope that we have, our thanks to God overflows. And out of that overflow of thanksgiving from our hearts, we now join together as we worship the Lord with the giving of our offerings. I want to remind you also that there are worship cards in the pews in front of you, if you would, both for members and guests. Fill those out, and as the ushers come back after the offering, they will pick those up as well.
I have a home, eternal home. But for now, I walk this broken world. You walked it first. You know our pain, but you show hope can rise again up from the grave. Abide with me. Abide with me. Never leave, ever close.
eternity. We'll weep no more, we'll sing for joy. Abide with me.
Amen. We see at the beginning of the book of Revelation, in Revelation chapter 2 and 3, there are letters written to seven churches. And in these letters, God begins with praising the churches for their faithfulness and what they are doing well. But they also are pointed out to them their failures, their shortcomings, and their sin. And as we read through these, we are reminded of our own failures, our own shortcomings, our own sins. And as we look at their failures and shortcomings and sins, we must admit that we share in those same shortcomings and failures. And so we come before our God confessing those same shortcomings, relying solely on His gracious, loving love for us. If you would stand as we confess. Help us, Father, to be faithful unto death, and even in the face of daily trials, to stand firm. Forgive us when we falter, in love for you and for our neighbor. Forgive us for our idolatry, and for the times our lustful appetites rule our decisions. Forgive us for tolerating and making excuses for the sin in our lives. Wake us up from our spiritual slumber. Make us refreshing streams of hope and warm and healing springs of your love. Amen. And in that great chapter of hope, chapter 21 of Revelation, as we heard, the Lord declares to us, "To the thirsty I will give from the spring of the fountain of the water of life. Without payment." It is free for us because Christ Himself has paid the price for us in His death on the cross. He took our place, paid the price for our sin, and in His resurrection was brought to new life, that we too might have new life and forgiveness in Him. And so it is my privilege to declare to you today, your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Throughout the Bible, that life of the world to come is often described as a great feast, full of plentiful and delicious and food and plenty of drink, and of course the fellowship, the relationships with our brothers and sisters in Christ, and most of all with our loving and gracious God. As we come to the Lord's table here in communion, we get a foretaste, a glimpse of that feast to come as our Lord comes to us in His body and blood. It is for that hope that this gives us, that forgiveness, that our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when He was betrayed, took bread. And when He had given thanks, He broke it and gave it to His disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, after supper, He took the cup, and when He had given thanks, He gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." As we come to the Lord's table, He truly comes to us in His body and blood for our forgiveness. And if this is your confession, we invite you, come, receive that forgiveness in the comfort of our Lord Jesus Christ. I invite our ushers to come forward.
I just want to remind you also that there will be prayer ministers to pray with you. So if you would like to go with someone, just lift up some concern you may have or even a rejoicing. There will be one prayer minister up here and one in the back. You can get up during communion and at any time to pray. To him who sits on
Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you until life everlasting. Depart in his peace. Amen. I invite you to stand now as we join together as the body of Christ to lift up our prayers and petitions to our great God and Lord. Lord Jesus, we are in awe at the great wonder of the world to come. We have hope because we know you have won the victory already, Lord, and we look forward to that day when that victory is complete, when we see it with our very own eyes, that you have defeated death and the devil, and all the suffering of this world is taken away. Lord, that is our hope, and we pray as even as we continue to be in the midst of this world of suffering and pain, as we are faced with our own suffering and pain and sorrow and grief, that you would comfort us, that you would bring us joy even in the midst of that sorrow, holding on to that hope that we have in you, Lord Jesus. And Lord, we lift up to you today those who are in the midst of suffering themselves in need of physical healing. We pray that your healing hand would be upon Gerald and Mary Kay and Judy, that you would continue to bring healing to them, Lord. And even in the midst of their healing, Lord, may you be their peace and their comfort. Lord, we at the same time celebrate and lift up a prayer of thanksgiving for Olivia and Ian, as they celebrate the birth of a daughter, Charlotte. Lord, what a blessing this gift of new life is, and we thank you for the health that you have given to mother and child. And we pray that you continue to be with this family as they look forward to the gift of this new life and what you have in store for them, Lord. And we pray that in hope and look forward to, as Charlotte is brought to new life in you through the waters of baptism. Lord, we also celebrate and give up a prayer of thanksgiving for Jim and Marilyn Corley as they celebrate 49 long years of marriage, Lord, and what a blessing that is, what a witness it is to us. We pray that you would continue to be at the center of their marriage, Lord, drawing them closer to you and closer to each other. And Lord, we pray for those who are mourning the loss of a loved one, for the friends and family of Hubert Stoll, and for the friends and family of June Courts. Lord, in the midst of their grief, in the midst of their sorrow, be a comfort to them. May they be directed, and may they know the hope that is found in you, Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, we also pray for our first Guatemala team that is down now in Guatemala, Lord, we pray that you would continue to guide them and be working through them in mighty ways, Lord, that your love and compassion may be shown through their words and through their actions, and that through them, more people might come to know your great love and their compassion for them, that through them, those who are suffering and are sorrowful may be brought the comfort that only you can bring. And we pray for safe travels for them as they go to and from, Lord, that you may bless their going out and their return. All these things, Lord, we pray in the mighty and powerful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Lord, taught by you, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Let us sing together, Body of Christ. Thank you once again for being here, and ask a moment of forgiveness for me. I know I forgot, to welcome guests, so important guests. We are so glad to have you here in worship with us, and to show that gratitude, if you are a guest here, we do have a gift for you out at our welcome desk as you leave today. So once again, please forgive me, guests, for that. Also, one more reminder that for the one for 200, once again, going online to do that and to support this ministry, the Feed My Starving Children. So as you go from here, go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be.